Greetings, Benjamin J. the Victrola Guy, with another in the series. Now, as you know, for the last 7 months, I've been working on the process of recording Edison 2-minute cylinders, learning how to record them, with the intention of making custom cylinders, taking an MP3 and transferring it to an Edison cylinder. But first, of course, I had to learn how to record on the phonograph itself. So it's been a long, involved process. It really has. And I've spent hundreds of hours and hundreds of cylinders recording on this little machine to try to learn how to make a decent recording and all the nuances that go with recording an Edison cylinder. Tonight, had kind of a breakthrough. Now, as you know, for the last, 2 weeks or so, I've been talking about this proprietary process that I've invented, which I dubbed the Canophonic process of transferring MP3s to an Edison cylinder. And I've been using shaved black wax dictation cylinders. And the nice thing about these cylinders is they make really decent recordings. The drawback to them, of course, is the fact that they're dictation cylinders. They were not made for long-term use. They wear out in about 40 playings, and which is unfortunate because I've done a lot of really neat recordings on these cylinders. But I'd take them down to my shop, and I'd record demo cylinders and things like that, and then play them all day. And after 2 or 3 days, they were literally worn out. And one of the first ones that I copied that came out good enough, I thought, to play in public was I Am the Edison Phonograph. And it's a very difficult cylinder to find. When you do find it, it's not in very good shape, and it's also expensive. But now, of course, I can make my own copies, and I've got a supply of original brown wax cylinders. I've got 50 coming, and I've got several here. And so I'll be doing the transfer process onto these old brown wax cylinders. Now, these were covered with mold when I got them. In fact, on the inside, you can probably tell they're still covered with mold. The edges or the ends of the cylinders are white, completely white, as was the cylinder itself. But I shaved them clean, and you know, this wax had not seen the light of day for 110 years. These are 1902, 1903 cylinders. These are old cylinders. Anyway, I've been going on the Edison archive. There's a huge archive. The University of California at Santa Barbara has a huge archive of Edison cylinders. And not just Edison cylinders, but 2-minute cylinders, Columbia cylinders, indestructible cylinders, any kind of cylinder you can think of. There's a good chance they'll have it. And they've got them listed in alphabetical order. They've got them listed by year, by name, by performer. There's lots of ways to cross-reference it. You can find almost anything you're looking for. And I've got an original copy of The Preacher and the Bear by Arthur Collins. And this is like 1906, 1905. It's an Edison cylinder. And it's an original, of course, and it was in really bad shape. And I really like that cylinder, so I went on the archive tonight and started looking around, and I found 4 different versions of it, by Arthur Collins. One on an Edison cylinder that they had transcribed, and these are all MP3s. You can download them for free. And it was actually in fairly bad shape. It didn't sound very good. So I basically listened to every cylinder they had by Arthur Collins of The Preacher and the Bear. As I said, there were 4 copies, maybe 5. And I came across one recorded in 1905 on a Columbia cylinder. And it was a fairly decent copy. And so I downloaded it as an MP3, and then using my proprietary process, which I still can't reveal to you, not yet, I recorded it onto a cylinder. And the results were absolutely amazing. Now, I did this as a test, just a test of the process to see basically how it would work. And every time I make one of these recordings, I change the parameters and try to make them subtle, but I catalog all the changes I've made so I can have a repeatable process. I know what I did, so I know if it worked, great. If it didn't work, not to do it again. But in any case, I wanted to play this cylinder for you. This is a copy of an MP3 that I downloaded from the archive of The Preacher and the Bear by Arthur Collins. And when I played it back, I was just absolutely astounded, because this does not sound like a copy. This sounds like the original cylinder. It really does. It sounds just like an original cylinder. And I'm going to play it through a Witch's Hat Horn. Now, usually through a Witch's Hat Horn, copies don't sound that great. Played through a Morning Glory Horn, they sound quite good. But the secret, of course, is most people don't have a Morning Glory Horn. Most people listen to the Edison machine through a Witch's Hat Horn. So that's what I had to use as a test. That's what I used to make a recording that would sound good through a Witch's Hat Horn rather than through a Morning Glory Horn or some large booming horn that, as I said, the average person just doesn't have. So most people listen to the Edison phonograph through either a 14.5-inch horn or a 10-inch horn. But in this case, this is an original Edison horn. And like most of the equipment I have, the horns, the machines, it was junk. This one, the end, had rusted completely away. Pretty much like that $20 witch's hat, that giant witch's hat horn I picked up for $20. The end on this one, and the reason the ends always go is because that's where they're always being touched. So body oils and acids, and it sits there for 100 years exposed to the atmosphere, and it just slowly, remember, rust never sleeps. And these are made of steel. Now, brass horn, you don't have to worry about it. Steel horns, they're notorious that the ends are almost always gone. In this case, it was completely gone. So another case of coming to the rescue with a copper plumbing fitting. In this case, a 3/4-inch fitting to a 1/2-inch reducer. And I cut the end where it was completely rusted. It was just a jagged edge. Cut it off straight to get rid of the rust. Slid this copper fitting onto it, epoxied it in place, which gives you a brand new end on a completely unusable horn. I mean, this horn was shot. You couldn't even put it on the machine. And I picked this up. It actually came with a machine, and you know, they included it, even though it was absolutely useless. But it's an original Edison horn, and it had seen better days, so I put a new end on it and then repainted it. But the brass is spare. As you can see, it has seen better days. It looks like it's 100 years old, which it is. But the nice thing about it is, first, it's original, and secondly, it's now usable. So again, I'm going to emphasize, don't overlook the junk. Whether it's a junk machine, a junk horn, if the end's missing, it's an easy fix. All these horns that have a jagged end where the fitting that went on the machine used to be, you can cut them off, put a new fitting, you can fabricate something that will work. In this case, it costs $2 for this fitting, and I now have a usable, original Edison 14.5-inch witch's hat horn. So it now has some value. It is original. Whereas before, it was nothing more than a funnel, really. The end of this horn was wide open. It was about 3/4 inch across, so it wouldn't fit on anything. There was nothing you could do to it, except perhaps glue something inside of it, which wouldn't look very good. And it looks presentable, but the nice thing about it is it's usable, and it fits the machine perfectly. So in any case, I want to play this cylinder for you. I'm really proud of this one. First of all, you look at it, and it looks like a factory-recorded cylinder. These grooves are really, really deep, and they're really, really sharp. And holding it up to light, you can actually see the peaks on them, which is really, really neat. So in any case, this came out exceptionally well, and I'm really, really pleased with this, and I wanted to share it with you. So I'm going to play a copy, an MP3 that's been downloaded from the Edison Archive, of The Preacher and the Bear by Arthur Collins. This was recorded in 1905, and this is a copy using an MP3 downloaded from the archive, and then using the Caniphonic process to transfer it to a black wax cylinder. Columbia cylinder, but I think you will agree that was a absolutely superb copy, considering it's a copy. A 1905 cylinder that is now brand new. It's really interesting to be able to do this, and I can't tell you what a feeling of satisfaction I have right now of being able to take this blank cylinder and an MP3 downloaded from the Edison archive and be able to put it back onto a cylinder and have a copy of a 1905 Columbia Arthur Collins cylinder, The Preacher and the Bear. Now this is a pretty big deal. It was to me anyway. I spent a lot of time and a lot of energy and a lot of nights in this room where I've stayed up literally all night long making little or no progress sometimes, making huge advances on other nights. It's all been trial and error and manipulation and trying this and trying that and keeping a running tally of what worked and what didn't and what equipment I used, and it's been a really, really interesting process. But tonight was a major turning point. It really was. I've finally been able to make a really, really decent copy of an original 1905 cylinder. On the video, if I had uploaded this as a copy of The Preacher and the Bear, no one would even suspect that this was a copy. I'm quite proud of this, I have to say. It's been a long, long, long process to finally reach a point where I'm able to make a really, really decent copy of an original cylinder. And as I said, I've looked and looked and looked on YouTube, and I can find no one else that's making Edison cylinders. There's three or four videos of someone saying a few words into an Edison machine, one into a Columbia machine, a Columbia Q. This kid is recording on it, and Mary Had a Little Lamb, you know, four or five sentences, which is great, but There's no videos at all that I can find of anyone doing serious recording on an Edison cylinder phonograph. Of any kind, nothing, whether it's music or the spoken word. There's a few videos from a couple of universities, and there's the a few Sean Borey videos, his new project he's working on with this musician. But other than that, there's no videos that I can find at all on recording on the Edison cylinder phonograph. So I'm hoping that some of the videos that I've uploaded have been at least enlightening, and anyone who's interested in recording on the cylinder phonograph, I hope it has been of some use. And as I always say, if you have any questions or comments, drop me an email, thevictrolaguy@gmail.com. I would love to share the experience with you of being able to record on these antique cylinder phonographs. It's a lot of fun, and when I was learning how to do this, there was nothing of any value that I could find on YouTube, or on the net for that matter. There's virtually no information available on recording on this machine. No technical information at all. There's some real generalities, but even in Edison's book that accompanied the recorder when you bought it, nothing but generalities. There's no true technical information at all. So in any case, I just wanted to do a quick video. I've been in this room now. It's currently 20 minutes of 11, and I started this experiment today about 10 a.m. So I've been in here, 13 hours, virtually nonstop. Doing recording, shaving, and it was really, really nice when I listened to this cylinder recording for the first time, and I was pleasantly surprised and greatly relieved, and I'm quite happy with the results. This is, as I said, this has been a long, long process, and this is probably one of the best copies cylinder transcriptions that I have ever made. This sounds very much like the original cylinder. So in any case, if you have any questions or comments, and I hope whoever's watching this, feel free to make comments. If you have any questions, if you've done any recording on an Edison machine, please contact me. I would love to find out what you did, how you did it, how it worked, what you used for blanks, what kind of recorder you used, what kind of machine you used. If I can answer any questions, feel free. I have blank cylinders for sale. I have recorders for sale, speaking tubes, recording horns, anything you can think of for the Edison cylinder phonograph, I have. I even have listening tubes. So if you do have any questions or comments, please feel free to contact me, thevictrolaguy@gmail.com. I'm hoping that this process, this cacophonic process that I've developed, will be of use. Once I've gotten it all sorted out, I'll reveal exactly how it works and exactly how you make these recordings. And I think everyone is going to be really pleasantly surprised on the process and how it works. So in any case, if you do have any questions or comments, please feel free to drop me an email. I answer all my emails. I try to answer them the day I get them. TheVictrolaGuy@gmail.com. And as always, thank you for watching.